Welcome to the APG90 Foundation's Communications Training Program. I'm Jerry Kay, the Foundation's journalist in residence. The Foundation is keenly aware of the important role communications can play in your career and your career development.
Because we recognize that as a scientist, a lot of what we do is reaching the largest audience with our discoveries. This can help recruit new collaborators, it can recruit new sources of funding, and it can engage and inspire the public to participate in the discovery process.
And that is why the Foundation has created this six-month communications training program. We begin by asking you for a communications self-assessment. Fellows have indicated an interest in a variety of areas. For example, how to combine scientific detail with general information, how to field questions from your audience, how to maintain energy throughout a presentation. We meet monthly via Skype for 30-minute sessions. During our meetings, we explore the various components of presentation development, such as voice, articulation, breathing, inflection, posture, marking a script, gestures, eye contact, choosing an appropriate topic for your audience, and writing a script. During our sessions, I work with you to craft a presentation about your research, which should answer a variety of questions, such as how did you develop this line of research? Why did you consider it to be important? Is there a specific outcome or objective you're looking for? Where are you in the process of this work? And how will your research benefit society? I recommend that you craft your presentation to reach a broad audience, well beyond those with a specific knowledge of your area of research. Another component of our Skype sessions is a discussion about how to integrate images into your story. Images that will provide your audience with an inside look at your laboratory, the tools you use, an idea of how you collaborate with others, images that can help your audience understand your work. At the end of the 6 months, you will come away with a well-crafted story and the skills needed to present it at the Foundation's annual colloquium. Your presentation will be recorded for our video series, Crossroads, at the intersection of research and medicine. Here are a few excerpts.
And this invasion doesn't stop just at the uterus. What's really interesting to me and quite terrifying also is that placental cells make their way into maternal circulation. They're there in quite abundant numbers during pregnancy, and they typically stay around for decades after birth. And very rarely they will pop up as placental cancers much later in life in women who have had children before.
We anticipate that our studies on the genetic regulation of kidney development will complement ongoing studies in the areas of human genetics and regenerative medicine to improve the prognostic, diagnostic, and therapeutic options available for our patients.
And our hope is that this work and others like it will lay the groundwork for harnessing the cell type to treat patients infected with influenza or with other viruses that are capable of using rapid evolution to escape adaptive immunity.
Now, oncologists have long known that the liver is actually an organ that's one of the most commonly metastasized places and one of the deadliest places where cancers can go. But what is new is that we discovered when the cancers invade the liver, their anti-cancer T cells shut down everywhere else as well, including those circulating in the blood and those found in their biopsy samples at a distant site in their primary skin tumor.
In order to better understand metastasis, we need to understand those cells that are able to actually survive and grow at a distant site. And this is just a few cells. They can travel to the lung, the liver, the bones, and establish growth there.
By learning about DNA folding, we can have a better understanding of the fundamental mechanisms of disease. And ultimately, I believe that will help our ability to both diagnose and treat patients.
And so as I set out on my career as a neuroscientist, my research question became, how do the cells in the brain work together to create, store, and retrieve memories? And can we restore these processes when something goes wrong?
In addition to the live presentation at the colloquium and the Crossroads video episode, we will also record during our Skype sessions an informal media interview.
So, for example, my research into how important thermal cues are for host-seeking behaviors is already providing us with information that is relevant for public health recommendations.
What we found that was surprising is that leprosy is able to take your immune system and cause it to attack your own nerves. And that's actually what happens in multiple sclerosis as well. And so we are considering using this model as a way to study not just leprosy, but the many different neurological conditions that involve your immune system attacking your nervous system.
Communicating with your colleagues, the public, foundations, government agencies is part of your daily work and can impact patient outcomes as well as career choices and opportunities. On behalf of the board of directors of the APGNNE Foundation and our scientific advisory committee, we hope the skills you gain from this program will help you engage, inform, and inspire your audience.